we have millennial generation now blaming climate change for their small savings. So apparently 88% of millennials accept that climate change is happening, according to this story. And where is this coming from? So I read this in Market Watch. And 69% say it will impact them in their lifetimes. And so the one way that this is manifested in what is being called eco-anxiety, and with 72% of millennials saying their emotional well-being is affected by the inevitability of climate change, compared with just 57% of people over the age of 45. And in particular, what they said is, why should I save then for my, when the future is so uncertain? Now, partly I consider this a genuine tragedy, and that I think it reflects how damaging apocalyptic movements can be, and that they encourage people to be fearful and short range. I mean, this is true of every apocalyptic movement. And but when you have one that gains national prominence, then you can really have a damaging effect on people. And I would not be surprised if there's people who really do not take long range actions because they're worried about stuff like this. But on the other hand, I mean, this is a very handy rationalization for people who don't want to accept responsibility for their own lives, and parenthetically, who nevertheless want power to control other people's lives. And the report goes on to note that climate change may also have a direct and devastating effect on the finances of young people. Apparently, a 2016 report from the environmental advocacy organization Next Gen Climate said that the median 21-year-old college graduate of the class of 2015 will lose over $126,000 in income over her lifetime to climate change-induced costs, and $187,000 in wealth if that income were to have been saved and invested. This is from a study called The Price Tag of Being Young. Steffen, I don't know if you looked that up, but I mean, my guess is that those figures are just made up.
Yeah, but so in perspective, I'm not sure that they are like for sort of lifetime savings. I don't think they sound like so much. So it's like the Ted Nordhaus situation. Ted Nordhaus is a economist who sort of pioneered in this climate cost issue, like, you know, projecting how much will climate impacts put a drain on the economy. And so he won a Nobel Prize in economics for that. But he also found that if you really read into it, the climate costs that could be genuinely assumed aren't actually that great. You know, if you think about 50 years or 100 years down the road, you know, if you're losing this, like for an individual person, sounds like a lot of money. But if you think about, you know, how much money a college graduate will probably receive in 2030, 2050, that doesn't sound that much. But yeah, of course, the numbers are completely invented in the sense that think about how difficult it is to project the, you know, average surface temperature, let alone the entire climate system over the next 50 years or the next 30 years or whatever. And then put on top of that impact projections, you know, what will this actually do to agriculture, to the biosphere, to the cryosphere, to the oceans, and so on. That's even more uncertainty. And then on top of that comes an economic model trying to project, okay, what will a college graduate in, you know, math or economics or, you know, business administration, whatever is on vogue then, you know, earn less or feel an impact on that. That's, I mean, there's so many assumptions that go into this. There can't be a real number.
Right. And the question is always, as opposed to what? Because right, the assumption is, in effect, if things just went on as before and climate didn't change. But that's not the alternative that's being proposed. The alternative that's being proposed is something like the Green New Deal. And what, like, it, by any reasonable metric, you know, that would have catastrophic costs on people's ability to earn an income. So like there's just this common phenomenon of like, you have these numbers in a vacuum, and even setting aside that they're made up, like what you always want to compare are the different decisions that can be made. And what are, you know, your estimates of those? And so if the estimate is the Green New Deal or not, you know, as you pointed out, like, all right, $126,000 less income over my life, but I'm still overall five times as rich as my parents. Like that is a reasonable burden. If the alternative is, you know, I'm completely obliterated in my ability to pursue my happiness by policies that restrict our freedom to use and produce energy. One other thing that was worth noting, most millennials said that that financial constraints were the top reason that they weren't saving. And one of the people profiled in the story admits that, you know, it wasn't climate change that was the only factor in his decision to opt out of a 401k. He also found that continuing to deduct money from his paycheck for savings would make it hard for him to pay rent and afford the cost of living in Los Angeles. And I mean, I found that really interesting because, like, one of the factors driving up housing and rental costs in places like LA are NIMBYan green opposition to development that makes it more, you don't have enough housing for these places, and therefore housing is more expensive. The cost of everything goes up. And so, you know, to the extent that there really are challenges that young people face in savings from these kinds of things, I mean, I think that the green movement deserves its share of blame versus the fossil fuel industry, which has lowered the cost of every good in our economy and, I mean, really made our economy possible, so that we can have cities and so that people can earn, you know, millions of dollars over the course of their lifetime and worry about and be able to cope with long-term challenges.